couple of weeks. We got to enjoy time celebrating our daughter's graduation, our daughter Caroline's graduation from school in London, and then spent time in the Lake District up in London hiking and spending time with the family and our grandbabies. So we had a wonderful time. Thank you for joining us for worship this day. We please stand and we make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The first reading today is from Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 12. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim. I am the war horse from Jerusalem. And the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. And also for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore to you double. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading today is from Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Therefore you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges. For in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, that you who judge are those who practice such things, yet do them yourselves, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent hearts, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and well-doing seek glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek. But glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek. For God shows no partiality. This is the word of the Lord.
And thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the Gospel, the Holy Gospel, according to St. Matthew, the 10th chapter, verses 34 through 42. Matthew chapter 10, verses 34 through 42. Let's hear from God's word. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a person's enemies will be those of his own household. Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me. And whoever receives me receives him who sent me. The one who receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And the one who receives a righteous person because he is a righteous person will receive a righteous person's reward. And whoever gives one of these little ones even a cup of cold water because he is a disciple, truly I say to you, he will by no means lose his reward." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please join me in a time of prayer. Encourage you to be in prayer for one another. Whoever you're listening to this from, you may have neighbors in need of prayer. I encourage you to speak to your neighbors and get to know them and to see if they have any prayer requests. And maybe if they offer that, hey, I would like you to pray for this, to pray for them right then and there. To say, can I pray for you right now? And to join together in prayer for your neighbor. So I encourage you to also to check in on fellow believers and to ask if they have any prayer requests, to pray for them. Call them on the phone. We need one another. We need Christian community desperately. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. It's a great privilege that we have as Christians, as followers of Jesus. We get to go into the very throne room of God and to go into his very presence, because Jesus, on his death on the cross, the temple curtain was torn in two. We now have access to the Holy of Holies in the very presence of God, to speak with him, to hear from him, and to know that we have a Father in heaven who loves us and cares about us. Let's go before the Lord. Father, we thank you, Lord God, that you have given us this great privilege of coming before you in prayer. You are a great God, an awesome God, mighty to save. We praise you and thank you, Lord God, for the hope that is ours in and through Jesus. May we never lose sight of the promises that are yes and amen that are found in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. That we never lose sight of the fact that your love never fails. May we never lose sight of the fact that you are patient with us and long-suffering, not wanting that any of us would perish, but all would come to the knowledge of the truth. And so we pray, Lord God, that we would turn all things over to you, repent of that which we hold in our heart, which we know is against your will, repent of our laziness and presenting the good news to other people, repent of our judgmentalism, in which thinking that we are somehow earned or deserved your grace and mercy. Lord, work in our hearts. Make us into your people. Help us, Lord God, open our eyes that we would see how we can help one another, to be there for one another, get to know one another to a depth where we can actually know if somebody is hurting, somebody is in need, knowing when somebody is down, not just a superficial, hi, how are you doing? What do you think of the weather that's going on? But a depth of knowing one another and caring for one another. Lord God, produce that in your people, in the churches, Lord God. Produce that in a mighty way, Lord God. May we be just open to the leading and guiding of your Holy Spirit. We pray, Lord God, that as a people, we would proclaim joyfully the good news of Jesus Christ, that his death is for all people. He took upon himself the sin of the world, my sin, your sin, the sin of the world. So Lord God, may you work in a powerful and mighty way that we would bear witness to the truth of who Jesus is and all that he has accomplished for us on the cross. Lord, by your grace we come before you. By your mercy we are able to stand in your presence. So we praise you and thank you, Lord God, as Jesus has taught us, his disciples, to pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Shadow.
Good morning. We're jumping back in. We had a 2-week hiatus. We were away on vacation. We're jumping back into Romans. We're now going to be in Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. Romans chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. So let's go before the Lord in prayer. Father, be with us now by the might and power of your Spirit. Teach us from your word, Lord God. Conform us to the image of Jesus. Transform us, Lord God. Make us more into your image by the renewing of our minds, Lord God, that we would in all things submit all things to you, our gracious God and Savior. We pray in his mighty name. Amen. So at the end of chapter 1 of Romans, Paul described what a people are like who reject God, in other words, exchange the truth of God for a lie, and worship and serve the creation rather than the creator. And he said in chapter 1, verse 28 and following, "And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They're gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them." So my question to you this morning is, what do you think of such a list? Let's probe that a little bit deeper. If you were a person committed to Islam, for instance, what would you think of the Apostle Paul's preaching so far? The words that he says, the preaching that he's doing. If you were a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Sikh or even possibly a weekly churchgoer, what might be your reaction to Paul's message so far? Could it be that the reaction of a committed Muslim would be, "That's right, Paul. You tell those people, those godless people, that they better get their act straightened out. Those irreligious people, those people who deny that God exists, maybe for the weekly churchgoer, you writes right, Paul, you tell them, those people who don't go to church, those out there that deny the existence of God, you tell them. Paul even pulls in the religious with the wording that he uses. Notice what it says in verse 29 of chapter 1. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness. And he goes on to say, they are full of envy. They are gossips, etc. They're filled. They're gossips. They were filled. They are full of. It is them. It is those people. In a masterpiece of exposing the hypocrisy that we're all too subject to falling into, prone into falling into, Paul lets the hammer fall on our judgmental, hypocritical attitude. Chapter 2, after this whole list of things, he says, therefore, you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. That begs a question. What sort of judgment is Paul talking about here? For surely the Christian is supposed to judge between what is right and what is wrong. He just gave us a list of wrongs. So what is he getting at? Look closely at the list at the end of chapter 1. What they were doing. Evil. Covetousness. Malice. I'm willing to bet and to guess that when you think of something evil, the first thing that comes to your mind is not yourself, but maybe some horrendous deed that somebody else has done. Yet, right there next to they were evil, covetousness, malice. Have I ever looked with envy at what someone else has? For instance, someone gets accolades at work for a job well done. And yet, I know some things that they didn't do so well. I know some things about them. Have I been tempted to talk to another colleague about the failings of the person who just received that recognition? Is that a sort of envy? Malice. Surely, I don't want to wish harm on anyone. But has there ever been a person that has been particularly nasty towards you? And in your heart, if you're honest, you really don't care what happens to them. Or maybe something bad has come their way. Somebody who's particularly nasty to you. Something bad has come their way. And you think, well, what goes around comes around. They got what they deserved. Murder. He talks about that. Surely not me. Not a murderer. But envy comes right before that. Right in that same list. Have you ever been envious? Gossips. That's in the same list as haters of God. Also in the haters of God list are those who are disobedient to their parents. The they are And the they were quickly becomes I am and I was, if I'm honest with myself. I am somebody who has done these things. I was somebody who did these things. Peter reminds us in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, for it is time for the judgment to begin at the household of God. That's where it begins. The judgment that Paul is talking about here is a judgment, a wrong use of judgment, that tries to distract God from our own wrongdoing. It's easy to play that game. God, I know I have some faults. I'm not a perfect person. But compared to that scumbag, I'm doing pretty good. And the words fall like a sledgehammer on our self-righteousness, as Paul goes on and he says in verse 2, we know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who practice such things and yet do them yourself, do you suppose that you will escape the judgment of God? Do I believe, because I hold the right moral beliefs, that I will escape the judgment of God? The reality is that statement, the judgment of God rightly falls on those who practice such things, is applicable to me and is applicable to you. But when we're playing the morally superior religious game, we can take religion to a whole new dangerous level. The morally superior religious person may acknowledge that they struggle with some things, but compared to others, they believe they're doing pretty well. I'm a good person overall. I'm just fine. Pretty much a good person. I pay my taxes, don't steal from the grocery store, whatever. I'm a good person. Reality is that God doesn't grade on the curve. And so it's either 100% or 0%. It's not, hey, someone got a 3% and I got a 8%, so therefore I'm so much better than them. No, you still failed. There's no curve. I'm still failing. Secondly, though, here's where it gets dangerous. The morally superior religious person can easily become radicalized in a dangerous way, thinking in their mind, I could be following God if there weren't all these godless people around me to lead me astray. It is my God-given duty to eliminate the godless. How does one justify, for instance, maybe shooting an abortion doctor? How does one justify beating up a homosexual? How does one justify strapping on a bomb vest in the name of Allah and blowing themselves up and as many godless people as they can take with them? They have convinced themselves that they're doing God's work, freeing the world of moral corruption. Paul reminds us in all this that if you and I want to be the judge of the world, that there is only one who is in the position to do so. And guess what? It's not you, and it's not me. Verse 4, or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you're storing up for wrath for yourself on the day of wrath when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. So here's the thing. probably one of the hardest things for people who take the Word of God seriously to deal with in our time of moral corruption, which there is a great moral corruption within our culture, and moral depravity, and celebrating that moral depravity. One of the hardest things is to not allow our heart to grow cold and to presume upon His kindness and patience and forbearance towards us, but not towards them. God is being kind and patient and long-suffering to lead people to repentance. That's God's heart, that they would repent. For God's desire is that all would be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That holds true today. He didn't change His mind. That's God's heart. That's God's desire, that all would be saved and come to the knowledge of truth. There will be a day of judgment, but God is the one who will bring about that day, not you and I. You and I are there to proclaim that there is hope for the sinner right now. As you repent and turn to the Lord, He is gracious and merciful and will pardon you and bring about salvation to you. Now, Paul does hold out the possibility that you and I could be the judge of the world. How could that happen? How could you and I be the judge of the world? Verse 6, He will render to each one according to his works, to those who by patience in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, He will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and who do not obey the truth but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and for the Greek, but glory and honor and peace for everyone who does good. First for the Jew and also the Greek, for God shows no partiality. So you and I can be the judge of the world if by patience and persistence we're doing good. That's when you could be the judge of the world. Well, let's unpack that a little bit more. So Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount, there's a whole series of things that he says in Matthew chapter 5. And he says, like, you have heard it said. You have heard it said to people long ago, do not murder, but anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you, anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. How about adultery? Verse 27 in chapter 5 of Matthew. You have heard it said, do not commit adultery, but I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Verse 31, it has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce, but I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife except for marital unfaithfulness causes her to become an adulteress, and anyone who marries the divorced woman commits adultery. Oaths in verse 33, you've heard it said people long ago, do not break your oath, but keep the oaths you have made to the Lord. But I tell you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by the earth, for it is a footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head. Let your yes be yes and your no be a no. And he goes on to say in chapter 5, he says, you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and tooth for tooth, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. Someone strikes you in the cheek, give to them the other cheek. How about this one? Verse 43, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemies, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. And then he wraps the whole thing up by saying this in verse 48, be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. You want to be the judge of the world? You can be. Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. Do you persist and in patience always do good? Is that what you can honestly say? Oh, my heart, I want to do good, but there's so many ways in which I'm distracted from that and fall short of that. If you want to be the judge of the world, you must persist in doing good always. 24/7. Always. God shows no partiality. Says that. Judgment will come to the Jew and to the Greek, to the Jew and the Gentile. We're all in the same boat. Sinners in need of salvation and in need of grace. Rejoicing in the gift that none of us has earned and none of us deserves. Don't play the game of I may be bad, but look at that other person. I may be bad, but I am saved by grace, covered in the blood of Jesus. I don't have to compare myself to someone else. I know I've fallen short of God's grace, God's perfect standard, and I'm a person in need of grace and forgiveness. I don't have to play the comparison game. I need grace. You need grace. God has given it to us. In and through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. To Him alone be glory and honor. Father God, thank you so much for the amazing grace of Jesus. May we embrace that and not play the game of comparison. Pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Let us confess together our faith in the triune God and all he has done for us. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're having a time of confession before the Lord, and the Lord knows what's really on our heart, but what he's inviting us to do is come before him, be honest before him, come into his presence. Don't hide anything from him. Run to him. It's a mistake for us to run from God. We should run towards him and confess to him. So let's open our hearts and our minds to him. There'll be a time of silence as well that we can really pour out our hearts to God. So from the words from 1 John chapter 1 verses 8 and 9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's take a moment in silence to reflect upon our need for Christ. So, Lord, let us confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. But for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear the good news. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the gift of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for worshiping with us this day. We just want to pray for God's blessing to be upon you as you go about your week, knowing that Jesus is with you. I pray that you find a place to worship in person, to receive the precious body and blood of Jesus Christ, the sacrament of Holy Communion, as we receive the gift that he desires to give us. Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of your sin. We need to be in person. We need to be there for one another, to care for one another, to encourage one another, to just really lift one another up. So I encourage you to find that place of worship and to be a part of that. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Thank you.